Welcome, good morning, and namaste to everyone. Our esteemed guest and lovely audience, thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Himani Kaushik, and I'm a pre-sales consultant at Connex RM and Nepar Technology Company, which is based out of Noida, headquartered in Singapore. Connex RM, which has been in the education world for more than 3 years now in the country, decided to take this challenge head on and provide the schools with multiple options that would help them in floating over the situation with aplomb, thus keeping their pace up in the market for ongoing education and towards attracting new admissions for their schools as well. We also focus to bring complete digitalization in business world and aid enterprises in numerous ways, like bringing revolution in existing business by transforming it into digitalization. Second, aiding startups, emerging companies to convert their disruptive ideas into digital business reality using an agile approach across application, infrastructure, IT, and information security. So, before I switch over to topic, I want to extend my heartiest felicitation to Mr. Sumit Shukla, founder and CEO of Connex RM Pt Limited, for being recognized in the esteemed newspaper Times of India for his article on effective remote learning innovations in technology. If you can hear me, sir, I must say how beautifully you have articulated the overarching topic, which is touching the chord in the education sector these days. You have talked about all the nuances and the solution of the problem in very informative manner, which indeed showcase that technology can be a powerful tool for transforming learning. It can help affirm and advance relationships between educators and students, reinvent our approaches to learning and collaboration. Again, my congratulations to you and all the fraternity of APAR. As you all know, that the outbreak of coronavirus disease has been declared a public health emergency of international concern, and the virus has now spread to many countries and territories, which has resulted in schools shut all across the world, due to which education has changed dramatically. This marks a rare inflection point where the entire system is being forced to recalibrate its action and delivery channels. This situation also provides each of us with an opportunity to pause and ask a question: how can we collectively reimagine our public education system to be more agile, flexible, and resistant to such global crisis? A lot has been discussed on the impact COVID-19 has had on the economy, social classes, and the environment, but we are more concerned about the impact it's having on the education system. As the pandemic begs for a pendulum shift, the efforts can be oriented towards leveraging scalable and flexible digital infrastructures to empower key stakeholders at every level. For this, technology needs to be effectively channelized towards three critical levels: equitable access to learning, delivery of learning, and administrative efficiency. It's quite clear that this pandemic has utterly disrupted an education system. So today we are here to discuss and present on topic shape and direction of schools in future post COVID-19. Needless to say, the pandemic has transformed the centuries old chalk talk teaching model to one driven by technology. This disruption in the delivery of education is pushing policymakers to figure out how to drive engagement at scale while ensuring inclusive e-learning solutions and tackling the digital divide. Technology has always played a central role in the way we work, and this has accelerated as a result of COVID-19. Technology at our fingertips has enabled us to continue working during the pandemic, and most importantly, to do this in a way that has allowed us to make quick decisions and keep everyone connected safely. Thanks to this technology, the flow of information has been fast-tracked. We trust that everyone across our team and our clients have access to the latest information in one place and in a format that everyone can understand. COVID-19 has caused a transformative turn towards technology, playing a particularly pivotal role, and a significant majority believing the ability to work remotely will be crucial for post-coronavirus operations. The future is about access, anywhere learning, and collaboration, both locally and globally. Teaching and learning is going to be social. Schools of the future could have a traditional cohort of students, as well as online students who live across the country. So let's not just adopt technology into our schools. Let's adapt it, push it, pull it, iterate with it, experiment with it, test it, and redo it until we reach the point where we and our kids truly feel we have done our very best. Plenty of schools have already embraced this, but there's still a way to go to ensure all schools are ready for the future of technology. It's obvious that whether we bring technology into our classrooms or not, our students will be digital citizens for the rest of their lives. We all know that our students love technology, and now we have access to something students love and have the ability to channel it into learning. Access to videos, animations, diagrams, and more. Make it easy for us to show students what we're talking about instead of just explaining it. If utilized properly, teachers today have an entire world of tools to engage and involve our students in learning that no other educators in the history of education had ever had. With a variety of thinkers and learners that need other outlets of learning and applying their skills, a digital approach is necessary. When technology is used properly, it can significantly increase students' engagement from those who may have initially lacked interest, as well as improving their results. Over 70 research studies have proven that technology has positive outcomes of students at risk of failing. And these studies highlight three important elements: interactive learning, use of technology to explore and create rather than drill and kill, right blend of teachers and technology. Teachers can no longer simply teach page to page from a textbook and expect students to retain all of that information. Students today need to be able to synthesize, evaluate, compare and contrast, and manipulate and apply information in order to be successful. And implementing technology in the classroom and preparing students with skills they can utilize in their future is the best method for teaching in the 21st century, you know. So, before I over to speaker, let me explain how you can talk to us during the webinar. If you have any questions during the webinar, just write them to chat. We will have a question and answer session at the end to answer all your questions. We will also be sending you an e-certificate for attending the webinar. So now, I'm going to invite our first speaker, Prashansa Singh, who is a business unit head for handling client relationship. She has more than 10 years of experience and has been instrumental in delivering and supporting enterprise level projects for multiple domains, including education in multiple geographies. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Himani. I'm honored to be here today and share the online space with the esteemed guests we have with us today. A very good afternoon to all of you. And I would definitely want to interact more with you in the QA session, which we'll have at the end. So now I would like to start with the focus that most of the governments around the world, they have temporarily educational institutions in an attempt to contain the spread of COVID-19 pandemic. If I talk about numbers, some 1.3 to 1.5 billion students and the youth across the planet are affected by the school and university closures. These nationwide closures have actually impacted 72% of the world's student population, which cannot be neglected. And hence, it is definitely required to have a study of the impact it has had on the students and the teachers and the education system worldwide. So if I talk about a detailed study which UNESCO has actually put forward in many papers and in many seminars and all. So a few points are there which I have actually jotted down. I would just summarize them here. The very first being interrupted learning. The schools, they provide essential learning, and when the schools are closed, the children and the youth are deprived of the opportunities for the growth and development. Second one, poor nutrition. There are many children and youth who actually rely upon the free or the discontinued meals, the discounted meals which are provided by the schools. When the schools have been closed, their nutrition has been compromised. Confusion and stress for the teachers. When the schools have closed, especially unexpectedly and for unknown duration, the teachers are often unsure of what their obligations are and how they have to maintain connections with their students to support the learning. The transition from this to distance learning platforms, it tends to be a bit messy and frustrating, even in the best circumstances for many teachers, because they need to be adapted to those technologies and they need to be actually trained on them. Then the parents, if you talk about the parents, they are actually unprepared for the distance and the home learning. Like the teachers, they are also not prepared, trained enough to actually handle these circumstances. Then there are challenges in creating, maintaining and improving the distance learning. You know, moving from learning from the classrooms to the homes at a scale and in a hurry, that has actually presented enormous challenges for human and technical both. Then we find gaps in childcare. Now, in absence of the alternative options, the working parents, they are forced to often leave the children alone when the schools close. And this can lead to risky behaviors, including increased influence of peer pressure and substance abuse. Another one being the high economic costs. The working parents are more likely to miss work when the schools close in order to take care of their children, resulting in wage loss, and it tends to negatively impact productivity. Another factor is unintended strain on the healthcare systems. The parents with children cannot easily attend to the work because of childcare obligations, which have actually resulted from the school's closure. This means that many medical professionals are not at the facilities where they are most needed during a health crisis. Another one, increased pressure on the schools and school systems. These localized school closures have actually placed burdens on the schools as governments and the parents alike redirect their children to schools that remain open. Then there is rise in dropout rates. It's a challenge to ensure that the children and the youth return and stay in school when the schools reopen after closures. This is especially true of protracted closures and when economic shocks place pressure on the children to work and generate income for financially distressed families. Then social isolation. We all know that schools are hubs of social activity and human interaction. When these schools close, many children and the youth miss out on social contact that is very essential for learning and development. The challenges in measuring and validating the learning. The calendared assessments, the notably high stakes examinations that determine the admission or advancement to new education levels of the institutions are thrown into a disarray when the schools are closed. Their strategies to postpone, skip, or administer examinations at a distance are raising serious concerns about the fairness, especially when the access to learning becomes variable. Disruption to assessments is resulting in stress for students and their families, and can actually trigger disengagement. Now, I read somewhere long back that school is not a paradise, but school is a place where paradise can be created. It continues in the same way that the classroom, with all its limitations, remains a location of great possibility. In past few weeks, rather months, we have gone from classroom to teams, from pedagogy to panagogy. You know, much has been talked about the hastily made transition. But in the process, however, there have been much changes also. Perhaps never to return to whatever we knew of teaching and learning for generations. I'll talk about a few points which we need to concentrate on, you know, after the impact of COVID-19, which can be seen, you know, after the schools will reopen or after the COVID-19 scenario has actually been limitized, or, you know, the situation becomes a bit normal. I'm pretty sure that things will not be the same. There will be changes everywhere, not only the education system, but in all aspects of the society. I would definitely want to put across stress on a few points which I have observed and would want to share with you here. The very first being, fewer kids will go back to school when schools will reopen. Let me take an example of Denmark. When Denmark eased its coronavirus lockdown on 14th of April by reopening the schools and the daycare centers, they did that with concerns that it might become a breeding ground for a second wave of cases, which have convinced thousands of parents to keep their children at home. If you are a follower of social media, there's a Facebook page, a Facebook group, which calls My Kid Is Not Going to Be a Guinea Pig, with 40,000 members in the country as small as Denmark. And there has been an overwhelming number of parents which are asking the inevitable question, like, why should my little child go outside first, especially since the virus is still to be brought under leash? India is going to be no different. A lot of well-heeled middle-class folks may prefer to delay the return of their kids to school or colleges. And of course, with so many livelihoods lost, many poor parents may not be able to, in any case, afford sending their offspring back to school for a long, long time. Now, there are linked questions. Will this lead to homeschooling? Well, too early to say. Two, if the lockdowns reoccur soon and frequently, homeschooling will become a distinct possibility with middle and upper families, upper middle families, in fact. The second point I would want to focus is that fewer kids will go out of town and far from home to study. Talking about the nightmare of kids stuck in Kota, Rajasthan, having to be rescued and brought back home is still fresh in the minds of most of the parents. Till the situation settles down somewhat, most parents will prefer to find workable alternatives closer to their homes. The competitive exams are surely important. 80 of the younger ones will take higher priority till the viruses show at least a The third point, fewer kids will go overseas to study, which is quite similar to the situation we saw in Kota. If we are aware that every international conference in higher education has been cancelled or turned into a series of webinars. The governments are starting to reopen societies and they're restarting the businesses, universities. They're gradually trying to open their campuses. However, the students are not willing to go and start their sessions right now, even if the government allows that. They're actually looking for the next session, or they are actually attending the online sessions. Another impact, social distancing with little or no sports. The first bump, the high five, the warm handshake, the hug, that all will be gone for a long time. The personal greeting, the smile, the intimacy, the bond homie, all have been subtracted from the classes tomorrow. The class is deemed to go from social to asocial. Friendships, social networking, campus bonding, and huddles will all be on hold for a while. Invisible walls will come up, diluting in many ways the fun and euphoria of campus life. Sports too will be in a low gear for a while. The gyms, the swimming pools, maybe even tracks and fields will remain shut for some time more. And when they do open, the competitive sports and tournaments will take even longer to be reinstated. The next point which I want to talk about is that the social distance may lead to some getting socially distant. As it is, equality in the classroom has always been a fiction. The inequality, sadly, will only widen in the days to come. The caste, family background, social status, economic well-being, the kind of school you attended has invariably shaped the student's confidence to speak up in the class. The underprivileged would most likely always be the meek attendees who would feel afraid to say something wrong in the class. Hence, they would prefer silence over participation. And let's accept that such inequalities do exist. Then the teaching will go tech, as we all know that the teaching is being taken up by using the video conferencing tools. Now, to enable remote learning, the technology actually has kicked in and will also kick in big time. However, it is not necessarily inclusive or equitable. Remote instruction will require that the students have access to both capable computing technology and reliable internet services also, which is not always, unfortunately, guaranteed in India. Also, we talk about the Teams deployment. That itself isn't going to equal learning. They will be need to do more because they need to be backed with the back-end technology, the internet, to be available in all the remote areas. The technology will definitely will enrich teaching, but for that, teachers and technologists both will have to persevere and innovate. So we have to need to focus on something more than just online classes. Now, if we talk about the online classes, they will not only be about the content, in fact, the container, but they will also be about the content. It is possible to become so enormous with technology and so distracted by device-related and delivery-related questions that the insufficient attention is then given to how to use whatever devices are eventually deployed to their full effect. As we move to a greater proliferation of devices, combined with the fact that we'll be accessing more content from multiple places, a greater value will be placed on the content and how that content is used rather than on only one particular device. Viewed from this perspective, the future of education is in the content and not in the container. It's more about than just content of the course. It's also about the connections and the communities, the student collaboration with each other, the teachers supporting each other, teachers that technologies can help enable, catalyze and support as well in future. Then a lighter school bag may just become a reality. On an average, if we talk about an Indian school kid, they carry somewhere between 3 to 8 kgs of weight every day to school, depending on the age and the class he or she is studying in. In addition to the books and the notebooks, they carry a lunchbox and a water bottle. And technology may help in shedding some of this weight. Homework too may move increasingly into the net. It was already beginning to happen at a better quality schools. Expect it to become more ubiquitous. It may take time, but it will happen for sure. The next one being the FOBA and the bulldozer parents will intensify. The Generation Z in our colleges and universities today is a generation that has grown up in a truly globalized and connected world. These Generation Z, 25-year-olds or less, faced with cancelled exams, shortened school terms, postponed sporting events, and even delayed graduations will be troubled by both FOBA, which is the fear of being alone, and FOMO, which is the fear of missing out. The education in the days ahead will have to address the loneliness of remote learning as well as the distress of lost opportunities. We'll also see emergence of more protective, more pushy bulldozer parents who will try to propel the Generation Alpha, the children of current millennial parents, moving all obstacles out of their way to create a clear path for their entitled kids. Acting out as if nothing really has happened in the world around us. Another point, the distance learning courses may not be considered. As we all know that the distance learning courses are definitely seen a notch below from the full-time courses. Now with this, after this COVID-19 situation, most of the students will prefer to take distance learning, and then actually the distance learning courses will get their due advantage in the society. You talk about the blended learning and the personalized education. They will be going forward a great opportunity to develop new forms of blended education, which is actually much in demand. The matured adult learners in the future will be more and more interested in micro-credentials, which allow them to acquire specific knowledge and skills. The demand will be more to work on relevant courses or learning paths and learning experience that prepare students for AI, AR, VR, ML, blockchain, big data, cloud, data analytics, voice deployment, and more. We'll see a significant thrust towards experiential learning too. Now, the next point, learning outcomes informed citizenry. A vigorous debate has already been ignited on what online instruction means for learning outcomes, student satisfaction, instructor convenience, the cost of course delivery, and more. This debate, however, has been narrow and has unfortunately sidestepped discussion of equally important implications for in-class pedagogical interventions. However, at stake will be the monumental important issues of the very purpose of an education society in the system. Should its role be restricted to solely enhancing learning outcomes and creating a cadre of skilled professionals? Or should it have a more expansive obligation to deepen the democracy by producing an informed citizenry that is aware of its rights and possess the capability to exercise the tools of democracy for societal progress? Well, time will tell. Next impact would be the student debt crisis. This is more pronounced in the West. In India too, lots of the students, more their parents, are taking education loans. If the employment market does not pick up, the student debt could become a serious issue. So definitely the society needs to think about this aspect also. Another point, the AI will personalize the learning. The AI, which has not been much in use till now, will actually take up. The opportunities and the challenges that the introduction of artificial intelligence could bring to higher educations are significant. Today's colleges and universities, they're facing a wide range of challenges, including the disengaged students, the high dropout rates, and the ineffectiveness of a traditional one-size-fits-all approach to the education. But when big data analytics and artificial intelligence are used correctly, the personalized learning experience can be created, which may in turn help to resolve some of these challenges. With a personalized learning experience, every student could enjoy a completely unique education approach that's fully tailored to his or her individual abilities and needs. This could directly increase students' motivation and reduce their likelihood of dropping out. It could also offer professors a better understanding of each student's learning process, which could enable them to teach more effectively. Now, the examinations and the grading, they will also undergo a change. The AI will help teachers to deal with assessments, evaluation, the paper settings, making mark sheets, and tracking the performance of each student with less tedious time. With these tasks made simple, they will be able to concentrate more on the course improvement, the teaching quality, and the aptitude development. The artificial intelligence frameworks will also move examinations and the scoring systems to go increasingly digital, with the role and discretion of the examiner reducing. Now, that's a very important point which I want to talk about, is the chatbots. The chatbots will provide guidance. Let me take an example. Recently, the University of Murcia in Spain began testing an AI-enabled chatbot to answer students' questions about the campus and the areas of study. As this chatbot was rolled out, the school's administrators were surprised to discover that it was able to answer more than 38,708 questions correctly, more than 91% of the time. Not only was this chatbot able to provide immediate answers to the students outside of regular office hours, but there was a technical glitch in between. I hope I'm audible now. So yes, I was talking about the chatbots. So not only was this chatbot able to provide immediate answers to the students outside of regular office hours, but university officials also found that the chatbot increased student motivation. All of these benefits were achieved without the need of change the structure of the staff. One additional benefit of having chatbot at universities to answer students' questions is the large volume of big data that would be obtained regarding students' concern and area of interest. This data could be analyzed to help enable universities to create innovative new services and programs to further improve students' educational experiences. Now, the next one, the AR, that will make visualization, the annotation, the storytelling better. Now, as we all know that AR, the augmented reality, is a very powerful visualization tool. It allows one to bring an object or a concept into a reality that is otherwise imagined, inaccessible, or difficult to grasp. AR makes new modes of storytelling and creative expressions possible, with the experiences unfolding in real time, introducing new and alternate perspectives. It changes the way we tell, share, and even remember stories. But will all this happen in education? Happen soon? My guess is perhaps not all of it. Not perhaps in India, not for now at least. But more affluent West will surely see a lot of AR happening in the teaching. One can continue to discuss trends, seemingly unimportant ones like the shift to more and more digital will kill the skill of handwriting, even drawing by hand, digital teaching may kill books, and that however we may use technology and AI, students of science will still need labs to do experiment, medical students will still need caregivers. This is a lot to it. Lots has to and will change in the field of education and learning in weeks, months, and years to come. One thing is for sure, we are never going to go back to the pre-crisis era. With this, I would like to close my session for today and hand it over to Himani.
Thank you, Prashansa ma'am. Thank you so much. And I'm really awestruck by the list of features you talked about and about the new trends as well. Had we ever thought a small online solution can have so many features? I'm sure this combination will bring in focus to B2B combined with B2C model in the COVID-19 era is definitely a solution everyone should look forward to have. As I mentioned, audience, please keep trying. Please keep typing your questions in the chat box so that we can take those up in a question and answer slot. So now, without a further delay, I will turn the time over and hand over the mantle to our first guest of the morning, Mr. Vaibhav Srivastava, Head of Education Channels from Microsoft. With over 17 years of sales experience into public sector and education domains, he brings rich mix of experiences of setting up business, driving change, and exceeding expectations and bouncing back from failures. With a reputation of raising hand to accept new challenges, traversing unknown territories, he has picked up roles that were newly created or perceived as big bets by organizations. He's a digital transformation enthusiast and a proven business leader who is digitally transforming education from learn to use technology to using technology to learn. He's well recognized in information technology channel partners and customer communities across India and SAARC. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Imani. Can you hear me loud and clear? And yeah, is my presentation visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity and good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me. And, the 15 minutes that I've got, I may, as normally people expect that somebody coming from Microsoft will go deeper into technology, talk about software solutions, everything. But I will save this for some other day and maybe I will stick our focus basically on school education and what we as Microsoft are actually seeing the change, which is going to be, very near future. Right. So maybe I will not get into too much of jargons and too much of technological discussions, but maybe we can quickly run through that. What are we seeing as the shifting change in technology in the coming future? So, but before I actually get into that, right, let me just first, take an opportunity to thank all of you. I think all of us who are there into education, I think all the work that you do every day, the kind of changes that you guys have embraced over the period of 3 months and, ensure that the learning of the students and is not stopping, irrespective whether you are having access to the campus or not, you have ensured that using by multiple tools and technologies, you are ensuring that the learning of kids is not stopping. And so I think kudos for that. It's commendable. Normally, with all due respect, teacher communities and the school community is not seen as too much of tech savvy people, but the kind of embracement of technology that all of you have taken over, I think is really commendable and just ensuring that our students and the kids are continuing the learning experience that you used to have in the campus is also there. So thank you so much for that. Before I actually get into the future, let me just quickly talk about what's the opportunity that we have in hand, right? We all are educators and we as Microsoft, we are a global company. The way we look at the impact that we can actually create is across the globe, the number of students that we have. So we have got almost 1.5 billion students on the planet. The whole organization today has a dedicated education division who is actually working on to ensure that we make a difference to every student's life. If I have to convert right into India, we have got almost 250,000 to 4 million students in India. And the same technological advancement or whatever we are doing, our headquarters actually boils down to India. And we are ensuring that whatever we can do to make the lives and learnings, continuous for all the students and teachers, we are actually doing that. Now, before actually I get into what is there, there in future and how is the future looking, I think it's good to reflect on the past also. So I have just picked up an example that what we saw in 2010 and what is new that we see in 2020 beyond the COVID thing. I think we all know that we have started this decade not on a very positive note and not in a way that we would have liked to, but there has been few positives out of it, and we are seeing quite a lot of adoption happening. Now, if I have to actually quick look at 2010, and you know, if I have to go and take a frame of around last 100 years, we have seen a huge surge of investments that has actually gone into classroom technologies. The round boxes that you see on the screen are the kind of stuff that has happened in last 100 years, where you know every institute, every college, every school, every university board has actually tried to, in their best capacity, to make their classroom look much more technologically advanced by the phase they are in. So if I'm talking about late 1950s and all, I think the basic stuff of technology when it was picking up was there. If we move into the 2000s and 2010, I think we have seen the surge of computers, you know, some kind of robotics, bare minimum, you know, compute power coming into play. But what has actually happened in last 10 years is phenomenal. I think these are the four boxes that you see have really powered up our learning and teaching experiences to the next level. We have got access to the new softwares, new algorithms, the ed techs who have come into play. You know, organizations like APAR have actually, you know, have actually tried to make a lot of impact in the way the teaching and learning experiences were there earlier by using, you know, some of these blue boxes that you are seeing. Whether it is about algorithms, compute power is our hand, right? Just imagine the kind of a computer that we used to use 10 years back. The mobile phone that we have today is much, much more powerful. So we have that compute in hand. Cloud has just transformed. You know, we have seen all kind of cloud companies, including Microsoft, you know, really coming and surging up and making real difference in the kind of technological advances that has happened. Big data has picked up. So, you know, all of these four pillars that you see, what it has actually done is actually has helped the schools and institutes and universities to shift their focus from learning within the classroom to learning beyond the classroom, which means all the investments that we have done in classrooms will definitely continue to be there. I think there will be things when we will go back to our campus, but the kind of adoption that has happened in you know, last one decade, and specifically in last 6 months, has actually helped us take the classroom seamlessly out of our physical boundaries of a college or a school to their homes, to wherever we are, irrespective of where we are sitting, where we are talking. I'm right now sitting in my home and talking to you as if I'm like sitting in a kind of a conference room with all of you, right? So we are seamlessly able to share, talk, collaborate, meet each other virtually, of course, but we still continue to be as productive as we were there earlier. Now, what has changed? I don't think anything that has changed. Technology is nothing, you know, if you don't have the mindset to do it. If the examples are very clear in last 4 or 5 months that we have seen, I think we are the same people who used to at some point of thing at time was very, you know, not very sure that whether online classrooms will be something of the future, thing of the future, right? But there was something which forced us to look at it, and all of us, you know, including the students, I'm talking about the kids who are, you know, of a younger age group, to everyone who is, you know, senior professors and senior teachers in the institute or the school, have actually embraced it. I don't think things were not available before. All that has changed is our mind shift, and you know, obviously there was some of the external circumstances that helped us do that. Incidentally, you know, I was with one of a veteran educationist last Saturday. I was talking to him over a call, and I just talked about that, you know, how's the new normal treating you? And the funny part was, you know, he actually came back and said, what is the new normal? What we are going through is actually abnormal. It is not the new normal. So I said, no, but there is some things which have changed. And, you know, we just went into a minor kind of a debate. And he said, you know, Vaibhav, what we are saying is, what we are going through is actually not normal. And this normal is not going to stay for long. What is going to be the new normal is in the post-COVID scenario, which means when we actually go back to our campuses, when the schools open, when the colleges open, when the norms and the standard operating procedures from the government and everyone, you know, including the institutes are put in place, is going to be the new normal. So incidentally, it's a good corollary, and you know, it actually stuck to my mind, and I thought I'll bring it over here. It was an interesting thought, right? You know, it is what we are going through is not the new normal. This is a temporary phase. This is actually an abnormal, because we are trying to do things because of the force of external circumstances. What is going to be new when we actually open up, you know, social distancing? How do we really come back into the classroom? What are the options that we are going to have is something which is going to be the new normal. So, you know, just coming back to our discussions, this is how you know our discussions and what we used to have, you know, maybe a year back when I used to go and talk to a college or an institute or a university, most of our discussion used to hold around that how are we making our classes much more smarter, how are we making our campus much more beautiful, and there was very little or less discussions around learning beyond the classrooms or the infrastructure optimization, right? But right now, as we talk, I think the whole shift from classroom, because classrooms are stable, they will continue to be there, we will be going back to them. I think that is something which has already reached some kind of a saturation level. I will not say it's saturated, because there's much more things that can be done within the classrooms, and you know, we are a big promoter of that classrooms needs to be much more smarter and the new age. But right now the focus has moved towards, you know, how do we actually ensure that the learning is happening beyond the classrooms, and the technologies that I mentioned earlier are playing a big role around it. So what we feel, you know, and again, you know, it's all a collective input from the industry experts, people, educationists. What we are seeing is whenever we go back, whenever we open, it can happen a month or 2 months or maybe 6 months. Education is looks like it might take a bit longer. I think what we are seeing is while we will get access to the campuses and the institutes, as my previous speaker briefly mentioned about it, there will be some deterrents where the parents may or may not be able to send the teachers, students to the school as they would have been sending earlier, right? So there has to be an hybrid model that will continue, which means the schools and colleges will have to give options to the students, to the teachers, that okay, there is classroom which is open. I know you have you have some kind of an iota of doubt in your mind that whether the operating procedures that has been put into place are going to be useful, or is the kid going to be still subject to some kind of illness. We will have to coexist, which means some students will continue to be in the classroom and some students will continue to be at the home. And as educators, as teachers, as schools, I think we have to give that both the options to our students, right? And when we open, I think this is an ideal scenario that we give equal weightage to everything that we are trying to do in this thing. When we do this, when we create a hybrid model where you have options a seamless lecture or a classroom running in-house as well as in campus, I think we get an option and an opportunity to actually go and focus on the personalized learning and the standard assessment. You know, we have both the options in hand that what we want to go ahead with. And that's where, you know, the whole technological piece comes into play, and technology will continue to be a big enabler on that. What we believe at Microsoft, you know, the four pillars that will actually continue to focus on, we as Microsoft will continue to focus on, and our partners like APAR, who are actually, you know, the forerunners in partnerships and building solutions on Microsoft platform, will continue to focus on these four pillars to ensure that the transition from earlier offline to now online and to the future, which is a hybrid model. These are the four pillars that we need to, you know, we'll continue to juggle on and see how can we actually, you know, ensure that all the four pillars and the processes and you know, whatever goes behind to enable these features continue to be there at the school's hands and there. So you don't need actually to be physically present in the school to do all of these things. You can actually be anywhere and continue to add value to this. Another thing that we see, right? I think we all have seen this concept of lifelong learning. We are all educators. I think we have seen a lot of visionaries talking about why everyone should be a lifelong learner, and it is actually a very famous concept which has continued to be in the last decade, which means, you know, anything that is coming new, you should embrace, you should be, you should not be resistant to change. All of these things actually continues to be a part of a lifelong learning experience. But what we believe is going to change in the coming days is actually the lifelong learning will actually transform into something called as life-wide learning. I'm sure, you know, some of you are aware about this concept, but life-wide learning is nothing but experience and the, you know, experiential learning or experience-based learning rather than just a bookish or a blackboard or a monologue kind of a learning experience, which means if a student is actually trying to learn a concept, which anyways they need a teacher or a tutor to use to teach it, but if he can actually experience in a way, whether it can be a robotics, it can be an artificial intelligence, it can be machine learning, it can be a small video, any kind of these things, life-wide learning will continue to be will be the future, because there might be chances that people and the students and the teachers may not have physical access to their students, or teacher will not have access to students, student will not have access to the teacher. So, you know, we all have seen the positives and negatives of students learning at the home. You know, there is a distraction, there is you know, multiple kind of hindrances that come in. So experiential learning will come into play, which means from lifelong learners, we will have to actually step on to something called as a life-wide learner. You know, and we are at the helm of things. So, you know, if you, any one of you have heard or seen Satya Nadella talk, I think we are a big promoter of empowering every student on the planet to achieve more. And for us to empower every student on the planet to achieve more, we need teachers and we need to empower them in turn to ensure that the students are learning. So we are putting all efforts through our partners, you know, like APAR, and in, you know, putting investments, getting more technological features that is actually useful to the educators. And, you know, and I'm sure the partners like APAR are actually doing a great job in that transition from an offline to online and now online to a hybrid kind of a model. The base, you know, and the base platform that is required actually to do this is our partner. So basically we are partner led. We always we are a platform organization. We are not a app organization, or we are not a technological you know, company who actually creates applications for students or teachers, right? We give a platform where people can come and actually build on top of it. So we will continue to be the partner led. Partners like APAR will continue to be our forerunners, and who will actually create those momentum in the shift of technology that is going to be happening. And this is all going to be cloud based. Now there is when I go and talk to a principal or to a director or a chairman of an institute, there is always that hitch in mind that, okay, if I move to cloud, is that the end of the world? Is that what I need? Because moving to cloud means I get access of technology from anywhere, anytime, which means I'm actually great and I'm good because I've, from an on-prem kind of a thing, I've now moved to cloud. But what we actually go and suggest that cloud is not your destination. Cloud is the first step for you to, which actually explores and opens up the whole world of technological advancements that is happening around the globe. If you are on the cloud and if you are taking the first step on cloud, you are actually stepping on the, you're taking the first step, which actually opens up the huge world of opportunities and possibilities for you. Online classes is one just very small example, which means, you know, you are learning from home is one very small example of it. You may be able to do many, many more things, you know, while you are at home, or forget home. It can be anywhere, anytime is what we talk about. At Microsoft, what we have actually done is, just to ensure that the schools are able to easily adopt onto the journey of having the first one cloud, we have actually come up with a program which is actually running for some time now. It's called Microsoft Aspire School Program, where we actually touch on three pillars. We ensure that the education delivery in the school gets modernized. Transformation, you know, from physical to digital world actually happens seamlessly. And we give a lot and lot of free stuff to students for them to be, you know, be very, very future ready. Anyone who is interested on this, please reach out to us. You can just go and do a web search on MASP Microsoft program. You can go to the, you can write to this mail ID. You can talk, you know, call up this person, the number that is mentioned there. Just take a picture of it if you want, and we will be more than happy to help you. And over and above on top of it, I think, you know, our partners are there who can actually, you know, help you take to that journey. So with that, I think I will just stop. My 15 minutes are over. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm around in case you have any question and answer. Just put it in the chat window and I'll be happy to answer there. Back to you, Iman.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for bringing the insights, sir. And you were very correct mentioning this new normal currently is going to be normal in future. Indeed, more seamless and smart. The future is about access anywhere and anytime, both locally and globally. So now I want to invite our next guest. So let's welcome our next guest, an esteemed personality with contributions in education world, Dr. Renu Malviya. She's an associate professor at the Department of Education at Lady Irwin College, University of Delhi. Her doctoral work is in the area of family school interaction with Zakir Hussain Center of Educational Studies. She also has experience in the management of learning disabilities from NDT University and a certificate in professional practice, aspects of learning difficulties for children and young people with disability. Over to you, ma'am.
Good morning. It's our afternoon now. Good afternoon. And it is wonderful to be on this platform. and I really feel very nice and listening to all the esteemed speakers. I will be talking about the grassroots experiences and the opportunities. You know, talking about saying that this is not happening. All COVID-19 has created so many issues for us. Yes, it has created a lot of issues for us. But what are the way forward? What are the opportunities that we take out of this? So let me just try and share my slide first so I am able to be more effective. And like it is said, that we in the education system are just learning to be more techno-friendly. Not that we were not, but of course, as compared to the rest of the world, we did so many things more, which was non-technically. Is my slide there? Has my slide come? Will somebody inform me?
Ma'am, I think you have to.
It's
basically a Word document that is open here.
Pardon. So let me just say this, that the school teaching learning process, the college process, the teacher innovation process, all is changing. And I feel when the last speaker said that lifelong learning, the type of lifelong learning that has been happening in the education sector, school, college, teacher education, has been immense. And I would say that every one of us has really tried to jump to the opportunities. And what we see is that when looking at the pedagogies, we need to be, the pedagogies have to be placed. The child is a child. The child goes through the developmental stages. But it's a nursery school child. The nursery school child will have their developmental issues. The child who's an adolescent or a teen has their developmental issues. Now, how do we take what we were doing in the classroom? It's not only about teaching. It is the entire process of teaching to get the best learning out of the child. So now what we do is the basic fundamental principles of pedagogy, we are trying to enmesh with the technology. I want to say at this point, I knew what a webinar was 3 years back too. And when I asked my colleagues, I said, let's go on a webinar. And everyone said, ha ha, karenge, we will do it. But we never did it. Now in a day, I don't know how many webinars per week that one is attending.
I think your presentation is not shared. Some other document is shared. If you can please switch to the presentation.
Let me do that.
There's some Word document which is being shared actually.
Okay. Just 1 second. I was opening that document and reading from there. This is the PPT, has it come?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Just go on the slide share mode.
Yeah. The PPT remains there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So when we say is, now at present, during this COVID time, we have been able, trying our level best to take technology. With the support of technology, not only online classes in the school system, but the teacher interns, the entire teacher training departments have been sending their students, the teacher interns, for summer online internships. So earlier there used to be this thing about if you go into the slum area, there'll be no chalk and duster, you will not have a place to sit. Now, what are we saying? We're saying there's just a basic phone which will come to the family and it will reach the family only at 8 o'clock at night. That's when the father will come home with that basic phone. And now with that basic phone, you have to teach the child. You have to engage the child. And that basic phone in the slum will be shared by 2 or even 10 children together. And that is what we are facing at this time. And believe you me, we think there is, we are trying to do it and we have done it to an extent. Now we need technology. We need the stakeholders from the technology department, from the world, to give us these very zero cost equipment, 46% of the children across the country we are not able to reach because they don't even have a basic phone in the entire village maybe. So this is the problem, and I'm talking about this, what is we are facing right in Delhi. We earlier, as teachers, as whether school teachers or college teachers, would focus upon PPTs, YouTube, video downloads. That was our level of technology. Now we are onto so many different platforms, and we look forward to having resources from all of you so that when we talk about pedagogy, it's not only about having technology reaching each home. That's the first step. It's like having a chair and table in the classroom. The steps is how do we engage the students? How do we use the questioning skills to elicit the best from them? How do we form rapport? But believe you me, it's once they are on the technology platform, it's become far easier to engage them. Across teachers are saying, once we are able to get them onto the technology platform, the engagement levels are much higher. Once we are able to get the family to understand that the TV has to be off, the kitchen voices have to be off when we are listening, when the class is going on, the engagement of the students is much more. The reinforcement is much more. For us, the issue is how do we reach out to each multiple differences of learning styles? How do we reach and look for non-verbal learning? Incidentally, the type of learning that happens in a school system or any learning system is incidental, is far, far more, almost 3/4 of the learning. And direct learning is only about 25%. So through these technology platforms, the 25% learning is very easy. With a little bit of skills that we can develop, we can gain, we will be able to do it. But the other incidental learning, is my child engaged? Is there a problem with my child? Is something happening at home? Is there non-verbal engagement there? Is the child able to find that black color pencil and the blue color pencil? So these are the type of things which we come into incidental learning. Earlier you could get a leaf in the classroom. Now I want the child to go and see the stomata on the leaf on the tree itself without breaking the leaf. Yes, we can do it and we will do it. The other point that I want to say is the social distancing is a term which needs to somehow be removed, and physical distancing is the term which needs to come in. Social distancing is not what the coronavirus has created for us. We need to be away from each other physically, not socially. When we're talking about classrooms, learning is something which we have always said that it's seamless. And what the earlier speaker said, that learning, the classrooms need to be seamless. And this is a great opportunity for us to see that the stakeholders, the parents, the grandparents, the neighborhood, the school bus driver, the housekeeping auntie, everyone is able to help us, join us, not become teachers, but support us in the learning process. The information is being given by technology. Our job as teachers is to convert that into knowledge construct. And that is where we look forward to be able to take support from the experts from the Department of Technology. For example, this is the type of learner-centered learning that we would have earlier. And in the last 3 months, this is what we are shifting to. The classroom engagement from the physical learning environment has shifted to everyone sitting in their home, but at a particular non-physical level, the engagement has to be at that level. And we need to learn how to do it better. I hope, and we look forward to more things. When we're talking about the transition process, the non-digital learner centered process to blended process to a technology-based learning, the classroom, we would always say, has to be learner-centered. It's not to be those straight line rows and the teacher standing in front and just giving information. Knowledge construction doesn't happen in that. even before COVID-19, the attempts were so strongly towards to make a classroom which is like this. The teacher has to be there, and it's not easy for the teacher to engage students in this. Then with a computer, with more information, then a technology comes in, and this is where we are trying to reach as of now. And this is where our skills of what we learned as pedagogues, of how to engage and elicit the best learning processes in a child, to in the face-to-face thing, to the digital platform. The possibilities are there, but we need that technology should be able to reach out each home, each child. Some of the areas that we have picked up in the last 3 months is these apps. And I'm sure this is what we need from the technology world to please tell us more, train us, give us the skills of how, which are the other platforms, and then we will put our pedagogy into it and make the learning seamless. The MOOC, massive online, open online courses, which across the world, Harvard, Stanford, Michigan, you name it, across the world, they have opened their massive online, open online courses, free of cost, which was so expensive. And the number of online courses which are now free of cost, with some peanut amount of money for the certification, probably, maybe that's also free. The amount of learning, once the students have been engaged, once they have, you know, tasted how it can be done, the number of certifications that the students are able to gather. And that's not only certification, it is also the learning which is happening, which wasn't happening. And it is an exciting period. It is an exciting period where we are able to learn to construct knowledge much more. Reach out in a day, I am able to reach out to far more students than I was able to do earlier. So when we go to the so-called previous normal, the previous normal is never coming back, but there'll be some basic, some balance of the early normal and the present normal, and therein we would be able to use these platforms. I hope there'll be from what we see in UGC and CBSC, the blended learning will continue. And now that we have got the taste of it, we should be able to carry on using it. Some of the digital platforms which were already in place before COVID-19, their utilization is increasing as of now. And once you have been there, the chances of the education system to be there more over the years would continue. These are some more MHRD resources which are already there. We need to, when you look at them, the type of content is good, but the type of digitalization of the entire lesson needs a lot to be said for this and for these two at times. And this is because the teachers, the teacher educators who are developing this need more hand-holding in the area which is not their expertise. So, this socioeconomic strata child was already had the resources and we were able to reach out to them very effectively. Can you see how it is not face to face in the sense that we can actually, or rather it should be more being face to face as bodies, but the entire non-verbal content of the learning process is possible, and gradually we should be able to use this. but technology needs to reach each house. This is what we have been trying to do at the level where there are only nothing else but a basic phone. And the teachers themselves also do not have any resources. This is where help is really needed. When we come to the child with special needs, it's the COVID-19.
Sorry, audience, for the technical glitches.
I'm so sorry. There was a technical issue, flaw happening. Electricity went off. Yeah. So may I continue? Technology.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. Sure, you can continue.
My slide is visible there, right?
No, no, ma'am, your slide is not yet visible. You have to share it again.
Okay. So while this, I'm getting the slide back there, when we talk about children with special needs, a child who cannot hear. Now, technology, of course, is a big advantage. You get the captions down there. I'm so sorry for the problem that I'm causing. I don't seem to be able to get the slide on. Will the back team help me out?
Yes, it's visible, ma'am. It's visible now.
Okay. May I continue then? The slide is visible.
Sure. You can continue.
Right? And there are spoons there. Now, is that the slide there? Okay. Now, when we're talking about this is what's happening, this is how we are attempting to do, to involve the family. But the family did give this, the whole process of this education system, the school system was evolved so that families could do other jobs. Now expecting the family to be the teacher is asking too much. Let them do the parenting. And this is where the seamless learning is. Of course, we are trying to develop this whole process of how you can engage a child while you're involved with other activities at home. But that's a whole learning for parents which will take years and years to go, right? And why should they be made into teachers is the issue that we are facing as of now. The overburdening of the parents is what we are not able to handle. this is my child with limited resources. How do I, we are trying to reach out to them too, but wish they could get more technology, which was zero cost. How do we do that? Where do I reach these children? Even for them, even a basic phone is out of reach. See how the children are learning. Spaces, the homes are so small, where the only place is on a stair somewhere. The way ahead from here, what we need is almost zero cost technology solution for the last learner in the last village. What we need ahead is technology skill development for learning teaching, for teacher educators, for schools, for college teachers, students, and the non-teaching faculty, as well as other stakeholders. We know on cloud, there's a whole grandmother group who do a lot of tutorial work. So if the grandmothers can do it, so can great grandmothers also do it. Resource development. Technology bringing daily life, when I try to the lessons, the audio visualies, the learning teaching material, the universal design of learning material that we were doing was something which was a three-dimensional, two-dimensional material kit kept in a cupboard. You took it out and you took it to the classroom. Now that entire thing is we need the educationists, the pedagogues, and the digital personnels to join together hands to be able to develop those skills across the entire syllabi, starting from almost 0 year. We also need to bring in the indigenous learning that we already have. Professor Nair, who works with the children with early intervention program of children, and he has been observing and is documented in his work that women mothers who are non-literate, but they are more embedded into the native culture of our country as compared to people like us who are more westernized in the way our education was done. They are able to understand occupational therapy, they're able to understand those type of things and are able to do it with the child at home more effectively than many of us. And that is the seamless effect that we need to bring in there. The continuous comprehensive evaluation or learning, open book is only one way of doing it. But I love the open book examination, although I know there's so much of anger and frustration against it, because in the open book examination, everything is there. Now you take out the right answer. So it is not information taking from the child, it is knowledge construction from the child. So as I, the teacher, learns to frame my questions, my question papers better, I will be able to take learning to a much higher level. Mental health issues is another major issue which is happening. And because of being able to get so much of information, and that is one of the major reasons which is happening there. So being able to understand that it is not social distancing, but physical distancing, some of the mental health issues that my students face can also be somehow brought down. So with that, I presume I have taken my time and I'm open to questions from anyone. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, question and answers really take after a session because we have one more speaker to share his views.
Wonderful. We will do it after the session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. I'm sure our audience must have gained ample of information from your speech. So now, without wasting our time, let's invite Our last but not the least, Mr. Mohammad Azhar, founder and principal at Knowledge Academy, China, Chennai. He worked as an administrator at NGO for 1 year, joined an English and Islamic studies teacher at private schools for 2 years, started a new community-based school named as Knowledge Academy School in the year 2011 at Pamal, started a venture in the name of BRICS Consultants, which focuses on empowering individuals through training, coaching, mentoring, and consulting. Not only this, he has been awarded Educational Excellence Award by Economic Development Forum of India, presented papers on English language and published with ISBN number. He has also been presented as a speaker in the World Education Summit for the past 5 years. He visited Finland and UK schools himself to study the education system. He has completed Cambridge certification course in the teaching and learning. He has also been the speaker at EdTech Review India conference for the past 3 years. So let's welcome again, Mr. Mohammad Azhar. Over to you, sir.
Hi, good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
And are you able to see me the PPT?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. welcome audience, welcome to the session, and I thank Apar Technologies, Nancy, and all other team members for inviting me for this topic to speak on. Let me start hybrid teaching methods. Let me get into details of what is hybrid teaching methods, then how and why hybrid teaching methods is required. So, when I say hybrid teaching methods, there is a fundamental shift from teaching the children to learning, making the child to learn. So instead of the teacher-centric learning, it will become student-centric learning. First point which I want to address is learning for life, not for marks. So the fundamental shift from hybrid teaching methods will be learning for life. Whatever he is learning, it should be applicable for his life, and in turn, it should help in growing his career, not just as academic part or for reports, report cards or marks. This is number one. Number two, learning on the go, not specific in school. The hybrid teaching methods, which the shift is happening, is wherever you go, whether you are in UK, whether you are in US, whether you are in India, whether you are in Chennai, learning will happen. It's not learning beyond the school. And whatever you want to learn, whichever you, it's up to the child's individuality. Third, learning by choice, not by imposition. Given the post-COVID situation, this is going to pop up like anything. Learning by choice, whatever the child wants to learn, he has a choice. Now, what in our school, what we have discovered is our students, 5 students have started YouTube channel. One of them has developed his animation skills by creating animating video. One of them is painting. One of them is good in robotics. So all these skills are coming up. One of them is good in cooking. So these are the skills by choice they are developing themselves. So this is what this will post-COVID will open up these things. Learning to skill, not to know. Whatever we learned pre-COVID era was on the knowledge domain, just by knowing the books, the rote learning. Now the focus will shift to learning to skill. The skill will play a major role in post-COVID era, which was supposed to be done before COVID era. The situation has pushed us to get into the water and swim there. Learning will be global, not in local. So learning will be global when the world will become a global village. Then this seminar organizing can one is in Delhi, one is in other state, one different people from different state are collaborating and running a webinar. This is something which is going to be normal. Learning from experts, not by specialists. So reaching out to specialists, especially ma'am has told that MOOCs and other tools available from Microsoft or any other company for that matter, anybody can reach to any experts. If I want to access the resource from Harvard University or Stanford University or Cambridge University for that matter, I can access that. I can access the researchers. I can access the scientist. So that is something which will become a norm in post-COVID era in terms of learning. Learning accessible to all, not confined to specific individuals or specific people. Now, what you need in this today's learning in the post-COVID era is just what you need, a mobile device. And there are n number of apps available for you to learn. For example, Khan Academy is one, Byju's is one, ExtraMarks is one. There are n number of apps available in the market, free of cost, paid one, to access the content. This content is no more a demand. What is demand? It is how to apply that content, how to synthesize that content is going to be a challenge. The doubling of information is very high at this moment. So content will not be an issue. It is widely available given the technological era. Learning 24/7, not in classrooms. So there is no specific time for learning. Now in my school, children learn from morning to evening on their own convenience. We do run online classes, and hardly we run 3 hours classes per day. Beyond that, it's up to their choice. Whenever they want to learn, they can learn. When compared to pre-COVID era, where the child will have to from 8 to 4 or 9 to 5, or whatever timings, they have to be in the classroom, they have to be doing this, blah, 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 then to have learning. Now, post-COVID hybrid teaching methods will change that paradigm shift. Will have the paradigm shift on that part. Learning on demand. If a child wants to learn whatever he wants to learn, he can get that. On demand, whatever he wants. For example, a child wants to learn art, he can learn by being on sitting in the home. Continuous assessment will matter a lot. This is the fundamental shift will happen. The moment this happens, learning for life will be dramatic. Now we see a lot of boards have cancelled the examinations, from international board to local board to Indian board. All the boards have cancelled their examination, and their assessment is based on their internal records. What the child has done, not only on a particular examination, how the child has performed over a period of time. And that is what will matter in post-COVID era. It is not that one examination they sit and they decide. So that learning, if that happens, the learning will change from book rote learning to actual learning, which has to be happened. Exams, no more a say. So no more examination will have a say in the child's life, child's future, child's career. Though it will play a role, the importance of that, the contribution of that will go low. Learning for individuality. So in education term, it is called our personalized learning. Understanding the individual potential of the child and exploring that and nurturing that and making it a master over it will happen in post-COVID era, which is supposed to happen for a school which is looking for a future. Now, this hybrid teaching methods will obviously involve and focus on learning for individuality. Learning through collaboration, right now, the teaching apps, whatever is being done through collaboration. They have to collaborate with the peers through technology. As I've told you, learning for individuality. Now, what we have understood the hybrid methods, why we require hybrid methods? Because a technology will play a major role in intuition of it. Though technology is included in the administration of school, now it is going inside the classrooms. How? Because of AI, artificial intelligence, virtual learning, augmented reality. The assessment has been designed so much so that the child emotion can be tested. On what emotion the child is answering the question, that is the level of artificial intelligence coming up. Prediction of the child. Data analysis is going to become a major improvement in schools by technology. World is no more a local, it's a global village. This is one of the reasons why is going to be prevalent. Exposure of home learning and virtual learning. This is something which where I skeptical when parents and the stakeholders very skeptical when comes to India. Right now, they have got the exposure of home learning and virtual learning. What will happen? The exposure of this, obviously, what they thought, how technology will happen, technology will have negatives, how the children will learn, all those things is gone for a toss now. They have experienced firsthand experience in the current situation, and that is going to be, as most of the previous speakers have raised this, why my child should go to school in such a risky situation? Why can't they learn in home? And this is what is going to happen. Uncertainty of technology become a certain. What will technology do? What can technology offer to the people? How we can leverage technology in education has become now certain. The schools, our teachers, our principals, all the stakeholders, when they question what technology can do, has become reality now. How technology can make learning happen in these circumstances has become a reality. Data analysis of child's performance. This is going to matter a lot. How a child will be in his career? What kind of career? The more personalized, the more individualistic choice of career will happen on the data populated of the performance of the child through technology. Flip learning. When I say flip learning, pre-COVID era, the teacher will come and teach the concept. Now, the teacher has to kindle the learning. The teacher has to put a question about the topic. The child has to go and learn through different sources available, then come to class and have a discussion. This is going to be very common, especially using live classes and technology. Otherwise, information is not going to matter a lot because already the child is exposed to technology. And whatever we are going to teach available in the market, it is available in the Google. Work from home for teachers, which was not imagined at all Right now, all my teachers in my school are working from home. Global careers. We don't know what kind of careers will open up. But there is a fundamental shift in careers. No more engineers. Is going to be beyond engineers, is going to be beyond doctors, is going to be beyond architects. One of the, and can I give you an example, one of the most sought out job right now is data analyst, strategist. These are the jobs which is going to come up. Coding, all this which was not there 10 years before, now it's going to come up. Entrepreneurship will expand, especially in India. Why? These skills are the skills which is required for an entrepreneur. That if the child goes through this way of learning, entrepreneurship will become a norm for him. The education system for pre-COVID era, or whatever we were doing, was designed to become employers, not entrepreneurs. Now, this shift, which is supposed to be for India, for to develop India, become a superpower, will sure produce entrepreneurship. Project-based learning, so no more content-based now. You need to give them projects, make them engaged. Giving lecture is will not matter at all. The attention span of a human is less than a goldfish. So 20 minutes is maximum a child can listen or have an attention of what you are saying. So projects has to come in inside the integrated part of learning. Person is learning what the child wants to do, what is the child's individual talent, what the child has to learn, what is he is interested. Virtual school and home school will become normal. Social and emotional learning will become a key aspect of a teacher. Until the teacher understands the social background of the child and the emotional aspect of the child, and if the child is not getting connected, or if the teacher is not getting connected to the teachers, or if the teacher is not getting connected to the students, then no more learning, especially in live classes. Unless the child or the teacher is connected to emotionally, learning will not happen. Learning for different type of learners. There are different type of learners. For example, kinesthetic, auditory, visual learners. Now the teacher's job is to make sure that child should be exposed to these different types of resources available in the market, available in the field, so that the child of kinesthetic or auditory or visual learner can access and understand, absorb, synthesize the concept and enjoy the learning. So this is what from my side, and thank you for giving me opportunity to share my perspective of post-COVID era of education. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And after listening to your speech, I can firmly say that e-learning can be heralded as a key tool to tide over students' concern during pandemic. Thank you to all speakers for the informative session. So now, we are opening the forum to take some time for questions, and I request Prashansa ma'am to take over.
Thank you, Himani. So yes, I'm glad to see a lot of questions popping up here, and in the interest of time, we'll be picking and choosing a few of them, and I would request our esteemed guests also to support in that. So there is one question which talks about this security of the platforms, and which is the best platform to do secure learning. So
I would request Mr. Vaibhav Shrivastava from Microsoft if he can, you know, give us some insight on the security of the online learning platforms we have today. Mr. Vaibhav?
I'm sorry, I was on mute. Sorry, can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah. Sorry, there was some. So the audience here actually wants to know about some security features. If you can throw some light on the security features of the Teams platform which we are using with Elite SIS, that will actually help.
Oh, okay, thank you. So see, Teams is absolutely a secure platform from a cybersecurity point of view. We use our the Office 365 suite of security features into Teams. Curbing unauthorized access, it's user-based login policies which can be set at the back end, where what a teacher can do and what a student can do, what an administrator can do, who gets what access. I think it's all at the hand of the administrator or the policy maker who is at the institute to control all of these things. And it's absolutely seamless. If there's any particular thing that you're asking, maybe I can answer that. Otherwise, it's as good as saying that it's one of the most secure platforms, that is a collaboration platform available right now in the world.
Yeah, thank you so much, Vaibhav. I would also want to add a few points here. Like, there are a lot of features like recording. You see other platforms that do not have recording controls. We have role-based recording controls. The teachers can actually choose if who can do the recording and who can actually be a participant in a meeting. If somebody is actually creating a ruckus in the class, those students can be removed. So I would not want to name a few platforms which are actually facing these challenges, and I understand this, why this question is coming. So yes, the Teams platform which we are using with Elite SIS is actually has all these things. And if you talk about the data retention policy, that is also under control. Once your user IDs are all disabled, we'll not be keeping any data. And with Teams integrated with my Elite SIS, we have actually very limited requirement of data to actually create your user IDs and get you working on the online platform. So it's just enrollment ID which is required. So there are a lot of security features. If you want to go through everything in detail, our sales team will get connected with you and then they'll provide you a demo over that. Okay, ma'am? So the next question we have talks about how engaging are the new platforms, the online platforms. So Vaibhav, if you can just throw some light on the engagement features of Teams.
Oh, it continues. I think Teams for education is absolutely different from Teams for the normal Teams that you use for our office meetings, right? Which means we have tried to bake in as many education specific features into the platform that are required. For example, assignments can be done, you can do polling, you can do grading to some extent. There are options available where you actually creating classroom. I'm not getting into the basic things, right? Where a classroom wise groups can be created within classroom, there can be subjects, there are notes, there are recordings, when you actually record a lecture, the transcript of the recording is automatically populated at the side of the recording. So somebody who is actually if there's somebody who is differently able and want to see what has been said, the recording while can be easily transformed into the transcripts. There are many, many more things. We just rolled out the 7x7. I think it's not updated, but we will now have a window which will show 7x7 grid view. Then we have got attendance download feature available on Teams. So every day we are actually trying to fine tune our solution, which is making more sense for educated features, right? So the list goes on, and there are many, many more things that we are privy to at Microsoft, which are in pipeline right now. So we see updates coming up every week, every month, many, many of them. And I think it's going to continue. We are one of the only, collaboration platform providers who has a solution specific to education. Otherwise, most of the people will actually give you a generic solution which can be applicable for a corporate scenario, for a school, for a college, anything. But we actually have created a solution that is specifically catering to the education community. I hope that answers.
Yes, Tabor. Thank you so much. That actually brings across the details we were looking for. And Ms. Rita Dasgupta, I hope that answers your question. If there is any further information looking forward, please type that here in the Q&A section. Till then, I'll move on to the next question. So this question, I would request Ms. Reena Malviya to take up. Renu Malviya, my apologies. So ma'am, Ms. Rita Dasgupta here talks about how are we going to upgrade our skills to keep every stakeholder satisfied in a short span of time?
How are we going to keep the...
going to upgrade our skills to keep every stakeholder satisfied?
See, keeping every stakeholder, if I'm a teacher, and as a teacher, I have already been trained in the fundamental skills of pedagogy, of my subject content, of being able to reach, understand the psychology, the mental health screening of my children. My training in teacher education has already given me these. Now my work is to be able to be the end user of technology. The Microsoft personals, experts, they are the ones who are doing whatever. Now, I need to be able to join tutorials, connect with the technology teams, and understand the platforms. And once I understand, as an end user, I'm not the maker of those digital platforms. I'm the end user. And wherever, and then how do I apply it into the classroom? The example that I gave just now was, as a teacher, it is my job, a very fundamental job, that my students can learn, my learners can learn. I need to have nonverbal incidental learning happening, which was very easy when the student was right in front of me. Now, how do I use these platforms to be able to connect with each of the child? We use the chat box. We ask them to open their videos and give answers there, right? We look at, their responses, and I find it so much more easier now. At my age, I often used to, letting you into a secret, I would forget the names of my students once in a while, not so often. Now all the names are right there. I think it is a big added advantage to me. And coming to the resources, we need to take the resources from the open access and, as of always, convert them into the teaching learning processes material that we were doing. That now we need to do it online. I'm still using my hands, which I was using in the classroom. Does it answer?
Yes, ma'am. That actually answers the question. Thank you so much for the insight. In the interest of time, we'll have to cut short the Q&A session now. However, we have many questions here which talks about the costing of the solution we're talking about, the teams integrated with ELITSIS and the examination features we have. So regarding this, our team will get back in touch with you all individually and will answer all your questions. So my apologies that we couldn't take all the question answers, and thank you from my end for such an interactive session, and thank you all to all the esteemed guests be here, and I'm actually honored to be a part of this session and be a speaker with you all. Thank you, Himani. You can please close it with that.
As of now, on behalf of Apart Technologies, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all our guests who spared time with their busy schedule to enlighten and grace the webinar. Thank you, everyone. We appreciate all of you for taking your time out and being here. The audience, you will receive the links of the products talked about here and contact numbers of the salespeople to be connected. We hope to see you again next time. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.